Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. We are going to look at some basics of pediatric testing, and we're going to start with a little introduction and talk a little bit about sample collection. So pediatric patients not only have different normal lab values compared to adults, but also the normal lab values can differ in the various pediatric age groups, from infants to toddlers to children. There are certain parameters that do change. The measurement of substances in neonates, infants, and young children then is further complicated by the patient's smaller physical size and difficulty in obtaining blood and urine samples. So especially in neonates and infants, their little veins are so small, they are hard to stick. And then when they get a little bit older, they often don't want to cooperate, they can't understand, they don't understand what's going on. When they're in diaper ages, you can't get urine from a diaper, so you have to put these little collection bags that can stick on them to collect urine. Anyway, those make it challenging to get testing done in the pediatric population. Then the interpretation of any patient lab data has to be viewed in light of the patient's clinical status. This applies to adults also, but is especially true for the pediatric population. So this includes evaluating their symptoms, their physical signs of disease, and then physiologic parameters such as respiratory rate, heart rate, and blood pressure. So for example, the normal respiratory rates are higher in neonates and young infants compared to those of children, adolescents, and adults. For example, the average respiratory rate 1 hour after birth is 60 breaths per minute. More than 6 hours after birth, it's 30 to 40 breaths per minute. And then a normal adult's respiratory rates would be something like 12 to 20 per minute. So there's definitely some variations there. When you look at heart rate, the normal heart rate are higher in neonates and young infants. Then it slowly decreases with the increasing age through adolescence. So, for example, the mean heart rate of a newborn during the first day of life is 123 beats per minute, but the average heart rate of a one-month-old is 149 beats per minute. The mean heart rate of a one-year-old is 119 beats per minute. And the average heart rate of a 12-year-old is 85 beats per minute. And in adults, it can be even lower. That, of course, depends if they're an athlete or if they have any kind of chronic conditions. But I know, for example, me, my average resting heart rate's in the 70s, low 70s usually. So let's look at age group classifications and terminology that can be used when referring to especially neonates and infants and children. So gestational age, it's theoretically the time from conception until birth, but really the way to calculate gestational age is the time from the first day of the last period until birth. And so the gestational age is counted from the first day of the last period, even though technically, if you think about how reproduction works, they're not pregnant at that time. They'll be pregnant, if a woman gets pregnant, and this is what we're talking about here, then it will be 2 weeks in, okay? And so, because that's when a woman ovulates. And so if a normal gestational age, full gestational age, full-term infant is gonna be around 40 weeks, really the amount of time that fetus has been alive is actually more 38 weeks. All right, so the postnatal age is the chronological age since birth. So how many days, months, etc. since they've been born. Postconceptional age is the age since conception, again, really since the first day of the last period of the mom, but so it's the gestational age plus the postnatal age. And so this can be relevant, especially when you're talking about premature babies and like when they should hit certain developmental markers. Okay, so a neonate is, if it's a full-term newborn, it's the age from 0 to 4 weeks, and that's postnatal age. Or it's the postnatal age of a premature neonate with a PCA of 42 to 46 weeks. So that's a post-conceptional age. So if you see that the full-term neonate is usually anywhere from 38 to 42 weeks gestation, and then you can add about, you know, 4 weeks, a 4 week period span of time, then that's what you have as a neonate. So they're in that neonate age until 42 to 46 weeks of post-conceptional age. So a premature neonate is going to be a neonate that is born at less than 38 weeks gestational age. And as we said, a full term, we say on average, should be around 40 weeks, but there's some variations of 38 to 42 weeks gestational age. An infant then is from the first month to the first year of age. So once they've hit the 1 month anniversary, they've been, you know, they're exactly a month old now. They're no longer a neonate. They're an infant until they turn one. And then a child is from 1 to 12 years old, and then sometimes we break those down into specific age ranges we'll see on certain lab values there. And an adolescent is 13 to 18 years old, and adults are 18 years and older. So lastly, let's talk a little bit about pediatric blood sampling. So the blood sampling method of choice for premature neonates, and young infants is going to be a capillary sample or skin puncture. Usually heel stick is probably the most common, especially for the little bitty guys, right? But know that you can also do a finger stick, a great toe stick, or an earlobe stick. Of course, you want to make sure that you select the appropriate lancet for that. You don't want to injure the child. One of the things to consider is that because we're using capillary samples and not venous samples, often there are some differences in results that can be due to that variation in the type of sample that's gathered. So certain substances that can show variations are going to be like glucose, potassium, calcium, and total protein. So for example, a capillary plasma glucose concentration can be 10% higher than a venous plasma sample. Again, this is not comparing whole blood to plasma. This is comparing a capillary sample, maybe that you spun down and you're using plasma, to a venous sample that you spun down and using plasma. And if you think about it, at the capillary bed, the arterial blood is delivering nutrient and oxygens, and so some of that glucose, some of these nutrients can cross over and enter into the cells, and then the levels would drop by the time they reach the venous circulation. So there, it's not unusual to have variations between the two types of samples. All right, so this wraps up the intro to pediatric testing. We're going to continue with the next video. We're going to look at electrolyte results in the pediatric population. So, all right, thank you so much for your attention.